that's amazing. He's been running this EFF track for forever. And it just amazes me, as DragonCon has grown and grown and grown and grown, that he just kind of coordinates, you know, panels this size and communicates with everybody, and we all show up at the same time. And it's pretty cool. Okay, so this is Women in Tech and Science Careers. My name is Elonka Dunin, and I'm honored to be sitting next to the women here. They're just some amazing careers here, regardless of gender. Just some really, really cool stuff going here. So what I'd like is if everyone could, of course, introduce themselves, talk a little bit about what they do, and then we'll kind of go and we'll dig into their careers a bit. All right, carry on.
Hi, everybody. My name is Amie Stepanovich. I am U.S. Policy Manager and Global Policy Counsel at Access Now, which is a global organization where we work on issues where technology and human rights come together. Before I was at Access, I was leading the U.S. Domestic Surveillance Project at a group called the Electronic Privacy Information Center, which is also in D.C. And before that, I was in law school in New York working on First Amendment issues and the media. And so I am a lawyer by training, although now I've kind of bridged to policy. And if any of you are lawyers and have done that, you know that there's like this great fight between whether or not you do law or you do policy. It's really been kind of a really great path that has taken me here, and I'm excited to be with you today.
Hi, I'm Tracey Wilson. I'm the regional manager for TEALS in the Southeast. TEALS is part of Microsoft Philanthropies. We are trying to get teachers trained to teach high school level CS courses. So we are branching out into the Southeast right now. We are currently in Georgia, South Carolina, Florida, and Alabama doing classes on computer programming using volunteers to help train the teachers to program. Before that, I was a high school computer science teacher, and before that, I was a Cisco Network associate for the university system here in Georgia. So I'm a Georgia native and trying to up the education of our students before my kids actually hit high school, too.
Looking after yourself.
Yeah.
So I'm Kim Steadman. I work at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Southern California. I've worked on the Cassini mission to Saturn, the Opportunity rover. I'm currently on the Curiosity rover, and I'm helping to design the 2020 rover, which will launch, in, surprisingly enough, 2020.
Hi, I'm Cecillia Tran. I'm an engagement manager at a cybersecurity consulting firm. I handle client relations, make sure the project gets followed through. My consultants are staying in line. Before that, I was a liberal arts and engineering major at Cal Poly San Luis Obispo with concentrating in computer science and technological communications.
All right, hello, my name is Mika McKinnon, and I am a freelance scientist, which I swear is a real job. So I'm a disaster researcher, I have a master's in disasters. I am a field geophysicist, I am a science communicator writing in places. I used to work for IO9 and Gizmodo, now I'm freelance writing for New Scientist, Ars Technica, The Week, a few other places. And I am a sci-fi scientist, so I show up on set and I teach writers enough science to make interesting plots, or I am the stunt hand writing for actors so that genius scientist isn't standing up there stumped by F equals MA.
Afternoon, I'm Theda Daniels-Race. I guess I'll say Dr. Theda Daniels-Race since I'll be the academic in here. I'm a professor at Louisiana State University in electrical and computer engineering. Been there since about 03. Prior to that, I was a professor at Duke University for just under a decade and a half. So like I said, again, I'll just hide the gray hair compared to everybody else in the panel here. Background-wise, let's just say research-wise, I work in electronic materials, which is kind of a hybrid between EE and material science and physics. My friends say I'm a closet physicist. They say come into the light, you know, resistance is futile. But anyway, I work with electronic materials at the nanoscale, so looking at teeny tiny materials and teeny tiny electricity. And background wise, just I guess educationally, academics, they always ask you to say that, right? My bachelor's was in EE from Rice University in Houston, Texas, and my master's, thank you, ours! My master's thank God, my parents were not wealthy, so this was like scholarships and fellowships, y'all. My master's was at Stanford, and I did, got a master's on purpose. Sometimes people think in academia is because you flunked the PhD program. No, I went out there to see Silicon Valley. So I got a master's at Stanford, also an EE, and then finally my doctorate was from Cornell University, again, electrical engineering, with a focus on electrophysics.
I'm kind of sitting over here going, holy cow, why am I? I'm a game developer. I'm much more on the independent side of technology. I've been making games for 24, 25 years. I have no degree, to my parents' everlasting shame, because both of them taught at UCLA. My main thing right now is I'm a project manager. I'm a management consultant. I go around and I work at companies, some game companies, some non-game companies, kind of looking at their processes and technology and trying to figure out where are the clogs and how can we clear the clogs and make better, kind of conduits to help products ship more quickly. So, there's so much to talk about. I'd like to know more about the people in the audience that are here, kind of why you're here, what it is that you want to hear about. How many here, both men and women, are currently working in the tech industry? Okay. How many are not in the tech industry but would like to be? Okay. How many were in the tech industry and felt you're no longer in the tech industry because you kind of ran into some barriers? Okay, that's good. That's good. Let's see. How many women, right? How many in the tech industry feel that you've been running into barriers? So those are some of the kinds of things I'd like to talk about. I'm guessing that some of the things you've been running into are things that some of the people here on the panel have been running into, and we may talk about some of those. If we don't talk about those, I want you to ask. I want you to bring them up, because I feel that it's by sharing this information that we can kind of help move things forward. Maybe 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, there would have been many fewer women in the tech industry. Also, there were less of the tech industry, of course. But I'm really excited by how women talk to each other about some of these barriers. And by talking to each other, they go through them. Some women never have any barriers. Yeah, you want to be a computer programmer, you go in and you become a computer programmer. Some women run into barriers, and they're not sure how to get through them. So by sharing these things, we can move forward. And that's one of the things I really want this panel to kind of help with. Also, there's the whole role model aspect. I often run into girls who just don't have any idea of what careers women can go into, but by seeing women do some of the amazing things here, they are motivated to say, oh look, I can be like that. And so that's something that can help women move forward as well. Okay, so I'm gonna kind of get off my soapbox kind of there. So let's talk about issues. Has anyone here ever run into issues? And we can go down the line. If anybody really has something, feel free to speak up. Or if you've never run into issues, you can say that too.
I'm kind of dreaming of a world where you could actually be like, yeah, never ran into issues, never heard about any. It's been smooth sailing, no worries. Because when I was but a wee proto-scientist learning how to be a physicist, my primary advisor, he didn't like women and he didn't like Canadians. So I was like the essence of evil in his world. And he made it his mission to make me cry once a week. And he told me this, and it was like, oh, all right, fine. I guess I'm gonna cry once a week, and I'm gonna do this anyway, and I'm gonna graduate, and you're not gonna be allowed near students anymore. So, it's the idea that you could go your entire career without running into anything at all is, I would love that future.
Even men run into barriers.
Oh yeah, like a delightful future where everyone can be curious and excited and work on things that they love and nobody gets in their way, like, sci-fi, I'm down with that future. let's dream of that and work towards it.
Well, if it makes you feel any better, I had a professor that was very similar. Actually, I have a geology degree. Initially, I was going to be a geologist. Science geek. But I ran into more barriers in that field than I did in the tech field. But the head of my department was the same way. He didn't believe women should be in geology, and the only women that should be taking geology courses in his school should be the ones going to be earth science teachers at school, in middle school. So his main goal was to push me out of a full BS in geology and into an education degree with a concentration in earth science. He didn't win.
Well, luckily you got
a question over there.
Yeah. I have a question. The school experiences. Do we have a microphone for?
Yeah, this is over
there. Throw the microphone.
No, don't.
I can't catch.
Okay, your school experiences. You're well educated and well in your field now. What time period did the school experiences happen? I had a similar thing when I was in school, but that's been decades ago. I had a professor that thought women didn't belong in college at all. They should be at home barefoot and pregnant. And he literally told everybody this.
Yeah, so there's this aspect of you really keep hoping that these attitudes are going to die off. And I do believe that at this point I now treat some of my encounters, I treat them as an endangered species and squeal over how that I can't believe they've managed to let several decades of social progress pass them by, ask if I can photograph them for a book for the future. I was at a rocket launch recently where they asked me, "Are you sure you're in the right place, little girl?" I go, "Excuse me, what now?" So I was in university in the early thousands. I finished grad school almost a decade ago now, which is kind of exciting. I no longer have that like wake up with the nightmare that my thesis isn't done. I can laugh at grad school jokes instead of cringe and have that pained smile. So that's about how long it's been for me. I think that our earliest graduate is right beside me.
So at Cal Poly, since I was in computer science, there was probably 99% males in my class. I was always one of like three or four girls, and not only that, we were also predominantly Caucasian, so I was also the only Asian girl in my class. And I had a professor call me out once and was like, it was like a calc class or something. Oh, we have an Asian in the class. Like, sure. Asians are good at math, so you can ask her for help.
And how long ago was this? In the last 5 years?
Oh, definitely, like 3 years.
All right.
And can you give a little clarification on your question? When you say the school experience, plus, minus, or just some of the, as we were discussing, negative barriers, or just the general attitudes of?
Yeah, and like I've had some amazing positive experiences as well. Like, having positive mentors and having people reach down and help me up and having people be like, yeah, this is not unusual, this happens, it's horrible, I wish I could help, but at least know you aren't alone.
But that's when you say school experiences, if I may ask, you're, just to clarify, are you asking how students are treated in school or how the fields are for students entering school? Or?
No, I was just wondering about your experience in timeline versus mine, because when that happened to me, it was
still going on.
It's gotten a little better because that was
plus and minus, yeah.
And there's challenges with your professor, which has its own, like, when you continue the academic track, mm-hmm. you never leave school. You get to just have different experiences. So how has that been in terms of being a professor, tenure track, non-tenure track, all of the funding?
Shall I bring out my data? Being the engineer.
Sure. I know you give entire talks about this.
Yeah,
so.
This won't be a talk. Don't worry, I'm not hogging the panel. But, I can do this in about 4 minutes, I believe. Can I borrow that microphone? I think kind of one of the best ways to present what's going on, or maybe it'll be a little bit of a motivation for our discussion, is just get the bare facts. I don't know if anybody in here is old enough to remember just the facts, ma'am, just the facts, Dragnet. Just
yeah.
But thank you. Remember that. Somebody. I might need that because I'm going to have to run around my computer.
Exactly.
So while that's happening, I'm going to ask Scott and some folks to give you guys a couple of passes around. You guys got to share up here.
We have chemistry up here. It says Department of Chemistry and Biochemistry.
Hang on, Mika. Give me a second.
All right.
Oh, you got here. Pass it on, okay. You guys. And by the way, if you guys don't want this when we're done, I'm just passing up. I don't want to leave a mess in the room. But I'm sorry, I missed that thought over there. Okay, in fact, I got to borrow somebody. Let me get yours. Oh, thank you. This other side. Okay, so what you're getting in your hands here right now is a very truncated version of a lot of information. But I'm going to go through it very quickly. You guys are smart people, but let me just walk you through a couple of points here. All right, on the first page there, you see Dr. Donna Nelson. Donna, as I call her, but Dr. Nelson, as you can see, is a very accomplished professor of chemistry in Oklahoma University. Now, she's also a self-described Native American. And a few years back, she was wondering, is this working? Everybody got it?
Yeah.
She was wondering if there were any other Native American chemists in the country. So she did what became now very famously known as the Nelson Diversity Surveys. It's right below her name. Now, let me say right up front, diversity, of course, is much more than race, gender, etc. But this became a simple question, are there any other Native American chemists? And she wanted to find out. This grew into, I won't go into all the details, but as I say, very important, as I tell my students, always give the citation and give proper credit. So the proper citation and all that is in this packet. But as Dr. Nelson wanted to find out more, this work that she did, which I'll show you in the next couple of pages, ended up being, it's been in the National Science Foundation, it's published in Nature, which is one of the foremost scientific peer-reviewed journals. It's been New York Times, etc. And just as a side note, she was one of the chemists, or maybe the one, I'm not sure, for consulting for Breaking Bad, if you want to that show. Anyway, so go to the third page, and I know it's a bunch of stuff, and maybe Xerox a little light, but let me just walk you through it. It's a pretty busy thing here. All right, top left.
Is this on the screen right now?
No, I think just passing around there. I didn't bring it for the screen.
Okay, so let's keep this short since a lot of people.
Definitely. Or share, please, share with a friend. Okay, so top left, it says university, and it's a list of universities, right? Across the top, this is an indication of, let's just say pick a segment, of universities or electrical engineering programs, right, ranked between, say, 50 and 100. This is rounded, right? And if you go across the top there, it says white, black, Hispanic, Asian, or Native American. Now, let me tell you how to read this, because under each, let's just say white to begin, it says full, associate, assistant, and total. That refers to ranks of professorship. It's all professors, right, but assistants are the new folks. Associates are in the middle, and full are the, you know, older folks, right? What Dr. Nelson did was she took, it, and when you see, for example, go down under universities down to, say, the third one, New Jersey Institute of Technology, and run your finger across to where it says white and associate. You see the number 6.001? That doesn't mean that there's a fraction of a person, right? What she did was the numbers in front of the decimal point indicate the number of men. The numbers behind the decimal point, just to make it easy to read, represent women. And I'm going to tell you why this floored me. Years ago, I was having lunch with my dean. Two more minutes, I'm finished up. And under the column that's, I grabbed this off the printer, wasn't even thinking about it. Under the column that says black, I looked at where it said associate. And I ran my finger down, and it had 1.001. I said, oh, there's one black woman who's an associate professor of electrical engineering. I wonder who that is. I ran across my finger horizontally to the left and said LSU. I had no idea. It was me. I'm not saying it to brag. I'm glad, and I can laugh now, but that was in 2007. I about fell out of my chair. I said, what do you mean there's one African-American woman who's an associate professor of electrical engineering in schools between the 50 to 100? And the ranking, by the way, wasn't like, oh, let's take US News and World Report and pick out some numbers. This was very carefully done by Dr. Nelson. Now, you say, Theda, that's 2007. I'll fast forward, and this is where I'll finish up. I'm like, what happened over there? 2007, so that's old data. But remember, universities are like glaciers, right? In academia, it's kind of slow. So, and her newer data is coming out, by the way, very shortly. So let me throw this out at you real quickly, and then I'll finish up. If you guys could pass that around, please. Take one, pass it down like this in school, okay?
We have slides next year.
So, last minute. This is a publication from the American Physical Society, as I said, lots of physicists here, right? That's the Professional Society for Physics. And you see it's called the Gazette, and it represents the Committee of the Status on Women in Physics and the Committee of Minorities in APS. Where it says, look, I actually found this in my house 2 days ago cleaning up. I wasn't even planning this, y'all. See that paragraph from the bottom about what makes a physicist? Let me just read this to you and then I'll shut up and you guys tell me what you think. It says, let me get to the sentence here. Each year, just 20% of all physics bachelor's and doctoral degrees are awarded to women. The field is very white too. There are fewer than, get this number, 75 African American and Hispanic female physics and astronomy faculty in the entire United States. How many universities are there? Now, by the way, the numbers, if you go back to the chart I gave you for white as well, are not so exciting for women. So it's, I'm not just talking, obviously, I'm, you know, the black person here, but I'm also talking about everybody. 75 people, y'all. There's like, what, 5,000 universities or so, if you Google it real quick, in small colleges, four-year, whatever. Not about half. Break it down to 1,000, because they only have all in the physics department. 75, all right? And even if you throw in white for women in physics and astronomy like professors, it's still an abysmally low number. So if nothing else, I thank you all, and I'm honored to be here, because this panel, the importance of it is not just for women and or minorities, the importance of it is for people, and I was just even saying the U.S., because one of the ways we're bleeding, if you will, is people aren't going as much into the doctoral levels, and we have, and believe me, this is no Donald Trump stuff, God forbid, but if you're interested, I even have stats on, you know, what's happening with PhDs. We have a lot of students, most all my grad students typically are international students, and they're phenomenal, but we're not seeing the women, we're not seeing quote-unquote minorities, like this woman's saying, oh, there's an Asian in the class, you know, stupid stuff like that. And if you guys want to get really racy, we can talk about professors that would take, not me, but have taken their students to like a strip club after the conference and sit there, and then that's where the deals are made up. Oh, there's a postdoc here, there's this, and the woman doesn't go, and you find out that all these things have been done.
Or so if she does go, it ends up being yet another story that we break on probably BuzzFeed about sexual harassment of women in science.
Okay, didn't mean to stop at a strip club, though.
As I'm thinking, and I think I know seven of the black women professors in physics. I should not know a significant percentage of an entire classification of, like, there should not be, hey, do you know Bob in Canada? The answer shouldn't be yes. The answer shouldn't be, hey, do you know Chandra? Yes, yes I do. We've met a couple of times. We're doing a talk later this year. I shouldn't know 10% of the women who are the black women astronomy profs in the U.S.
Well, let me tell you how it feeds upon itself. NSF used to put out numbers like Dr. Nelson did, and several years ago they stopped. And you know what the reason was? Nothing against NSF.
Too depressing?
I was still going to get funded, okay? Love NSF. But they said they're stopping putting that information out because it was too easy to identify the people by name. That's and they thought it was a privacy violation. But then you don't find out what's going on.
It definitely, when you have small populations, so one of the issues with having small populations is that first there's a privacy issue, but then there's a you become the representative of an entire group issue. Yes. Yeah. And I don't have the data on hand because I didn't do my prep very well. I moved out of my apartment on Wednesday night and flew out to DragonCon at 4 in the morning. I slept in the airport. So my prep was very well. There is some data somewhere that until you have something like 10% representation, then everybody is, oh, you are the representative of every Asian in the entire world. You are the representative of all gay physicists are you, which puts undue pressure because then you can't just be a human being, you're an archetype. You are representing your entire set of descriptors and you can no longer be a human. You have to be a fake front. And that is really dangerous and really damaging.
Well, the feeling that you have to be a fake front. I mean, some people just go out there and say, okay, I am the only transgender who's a PhD, medieval history or something. Oh my God, I have to put myself forward as an example of what transgender, PhD, but no, sometimes you just go, I'm me. And if other people want to see me as an example, that's their issue, but I'm just going to keep being me.
It can run into problems, though, when it's things. So I did field work for a while, and there are a countable number of women who are field geophysicists in Canada. I've worked with over 60% of them. I've met all of them. There are not many. And I would consistently be called Vicky because 20 years earlier, there was a brunette woman geophysicist. Therefore, we are the same person. And my name is Vicky. And I have have engaged in 20 years.
we have a couple questions. One was over there, and then there's a couple here. Scott, is anybody a runner?
I can come get it.
All right, self-running. Come grab the mic.
We're recording this, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, put them up here. Thank you. We see each other every year. I'm a former software engineer. I went to North Carolina A&T State University.
Can you speak? I can't hear you, right?
I went to North Carolina State University as computer science. But one of the things that, and I'm from North Carolina, one of the things that I do is work with middle school girls, 7th and 8th grade. Because of the data that you mentioned and the comments that I'm hearing, the experience that you have in college and in your careers, those are valid, but we're losing the girls.
We're losing them in middle school, yeah.
At middle school. And one of the reasons that we're losing them is the same experiences that you're talking about in college, they experience in middle school, where the teachers don't recognize them, that they're afraid to talk and say an answer because they might be wrong if they're in a room with boys. Whereas the boys can raise their hands, I'm wrong, but I don't care. I've gotten to say something. A girl raises her hand and she's wrong. Well, you don't know anything. You're stupid. Mm-hmm. No, the negative connotation. And until you change that,
yes,
you can't fix the high school and college. Because when I was in high school, my high school counselor told me I needed to go in the factory. But being that I am in my hometown, what we refer to as one of those family children, I got up and went to a different, I got up from my high school counselor, went to a different counselor and said, this is what I want to do, how do I do it? I forced myself to say, I'm not going to be with somebody else, but everybody doesn't have that personality. So how do you address, we have a problem starting in middle school with the 7th and 8th grade girls,
we have
to get them encouraged to stay, and they love science, but when they get into that classroom, because I meet them every day, I want to be the doctor, I want to be the bio, the food scientist. They know the careers, but something happens by the time they get to high school, they give up.
And can I add another data point into that as well? So I help with a lot of conference organizing and adding professional career women onto panels. And women who are incredibly qualified, incredibly amazing people who I work with and who I don't work with, unfortunately. And in my experience over many, many years, unless the woman knows exactly the subject matter of exactly that panel and thinks that she is an expert on that issue, she will turn down the panel. And she will say, I am not the expert, please move on to somebody else who actually can speak on this issue. When you invite men onto a panel, overwhelmingly, not all of them, if they have an opinion on the subject matter, even if it's not exactly what they work on, they will say yes, and they'll be like, of course I can contribute to that conversation. I have something to add. And it's that same middle school mentality. I don't know if we're getting over that or if people are just learning to deal with it. And I think that's important to note. It's not like we're fixing it. Or for the people who have somehow made it past middle school and continued in those careers, they don't feel like that's ever been fixed. They still feel like they cannot speak up unless they know the exact answer, exactly how it needs to be said in a crowd full of people, because if they say something wrong, they'll be attacked. And that idea that you're going to be attacked lives very, very much at the forefront of the consciousness of a lot of professional women.
Yes. And I want to ask, if you have a question or comment from this point on, if you could line up here, and then we'll take you in order.
So I'm going to just do here's a tip to make things slightly better. Which is, again, more data, because again, we're a panel of people who like data. There is statistics on women tend to not apply for jobs unless they meet 90 or greater of the qualification. Men tend to apply for jobs at 50% or greater. So, women in the audience, if you see a job and think, I could do that, ignore the qualifications list and apply anyway. Don't self-filter yourself out. You out. They might not even know who you're looking for. Right now, I'm in application to be an astronaut. I will not make it. There is no way. I fully expect to get filtered out at the next stage. But you know what? I made it to the first stage. I applied, and I got to do the first round testing. They thought I was that qualified. It's okay. do it anyway. And men in the audience, encourage the women in your life to do this. If you see them and go, you could do this job, push them to apply. When they start freaking out and go, oh, I'm never gonna make it, go, well, you're not gonna make it unless you apply. Do it. Let the hiring committee filter you out.
And I have a lot of experience with public education. I taught 8th through 12th grade for 13 years here in Georgia and computer science. And not only did my first class, my first year, I started being 100% male, they actually had enough nerve to ask me why there were no chicks in this class.
Yes.
We had a very long discussion about why we would not be referring to anybody female as a chick in my class again. But I built a program over the course of a decade where by the time I left and took the job I have now, and I left because I thought I could reach more students, not because I disliked teaching, is we went from having 0% of girls in my class to over 30% girls in my class. Because I made the effort to go out and recruit them. But what we definitely have a problem, because I have taught 8th grade girls and 8th grade boys, and the boys honestly don't have a filter at all, sorry, you don't at that age. But the girls won't speak up, they won't ask questions. You have to kind of read their body language to begin with to know that they're lost. And I'm not sure when they lose that, because I've worked with elementary school kids too, and they're not that fearful in elementary school. I don't know what happens between 5th and 6th grade, but it's like they forget that they can speak up.
So parents. Yeah. Why we need, my husband and our parents, I got that guy over there who pushes me with, you know, you can do it, whether they think so or not. My dear husband, Dr. Paul Anthony Race, I got to say, he's actually a physician and later went to law school, not because he got sued or anything, it was just because of law. But I say for that very same thing, that's why this is so important for the men and the women, because they're fathers and brothers and uncles and whatnot, and you've got gems, diamonds, you know, in the rough in your homes, and you've got to move them ahead. But I'm going to shut up because I know there's some folks here.
Yeah. So just before we leave this topic, I currently have a lot of nieces and nephews who are teeny, teeny, tiny, like 4 and younger, 5 and younger. And they're all excited about rocks and dinosaurs. And it's all, Auntie Mika, can I have this rock? Can we like roar like dinosaurs and run? And it's both the boys and the girls are doing this. So at tiny ages, they have not yet had the cultural impression of you can't do things. So again, things you can actually do is if you have interactions with tiny wee people who are still growing and shaping their world, ask them what they're curious about. Encourage them to solve problems. Play with them with science and technology, and don't just do the, well, you're the boy, you can play in the mud, you're the girl, you can have a doll.
Yeah,
like, don't. Cultural change is hard, and it takes everybody working on it, but we can do it.
And I was lucky. I had parents that never thought I had to be a girly girl and had to dress in dresses and stay clean and stuff, but we need to stop telling our little girls that they're supposed to be pretty and clean and never play in the dirt.
Yeah, I got this jacket from Good Money. I don't have time to shop.
I have basically it boils down to two questions. The first one is, has anyone ever looked at you and not believed you're in tech and an engineer? Because I work at a small app making company, and I'm a developer, and I've definitely had a lot of people basically come up to me and say, oh, are you an HR or whatever?
The secretary.
Because you're too outgoing, you're too XYZ, and or are you a designer or something?
I've been to conferences at hotels, and like I tried to put on a little bit of lipstick today, y'all. It's not, you know, anyway. depending on the conference, some are, you know, maybe even jeans or business casual. And I've had people ask me where the trash cans are, or the water, or whatever, because, you know, folks look like me don't really attend. And I've been at conferences where I'm the only female or the only minority, you know, as we define in the U.S. So, but so be it. I mean, I'm not saying that's great. That is part of the environment, but there's a happy ending to this, y'all. At the end, I'll tell you some happy stuff.
I really want to hear Kim, who's been talking way too much on this panel. I mean, has anyone ever looked at you and been surprised by what you do, or do you ever feel pressure to look like a rocket scientist?
Well, there's always that panic when somebody wants you to help them fix something, and you're like, oh, it's not going to happen. But yeah, I mean, you know, I have a husband who I love and he's absolutely wonderful, and sometimes when we meet new people, they talk to him and they don't talk to me, or when they do ask me what I do, they do a double take and they say, really? And then I just use a lot of acronyms because I work in an acronym, JPL. So I can drop the acronyms with the best of them, and then they have no idea what I'm talking about and they feel totally stupid and I move on.
Related question. So across tech companies, especially the big ones like Google and Microsoft and them, women in tech in general, like this is just across all departments, is about, I want to say 15 to 20%,
yeah,
for the good companies.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, good. So one thing I brought up at our women's diversity group is, hey, our recruiting in engineering in particular for women is particularly low. I can name all the women in engineering on like 15 fingers. I don't have 15 fingers, you know. Like there's about 15, 16 of us, and this company is over, like, I wanna say over 800 people at this point. That's not good. But when I brought it up at the women's diversity group, all the biz ops and sales girls basically just say, oh, we're working on maternity leave and family planning stuff. And I'm like, we're recruiting engineering people in general across the board directly from college, and I don't think a lot of these college girls are like thinking immediately, I want to make babies and get married, and then when I come back from maternity leave, I have to worry about XYZ. Like, that's not really a general concern for girls coming straight out of college. And so what do you recommend that we can think about for recruiting these girls in particular?
So one of the most useless things in recruiting diversity is to do it retroactively. Because then you've got, not only are you working from a tiny pool of people to pick from, but then you have the stigma of, well, you only got hired because you're a girl. You only got hired to meet our quota for having enough African Americans on staff. You only got hired because we need more diversity, which is terrible for everybody involved. So the way to get more diversity in your end product is to do it upfront and do it in recruiting your initial pool, and to go out at the beginning and go to women in science and engineering groups, to go to areas where you find the types of people you want to be recruiting and get them to apply up front.
Another good thing is to get the higher ups aware of this situation. So Google recently put out its first gender transparency report. And for the first time, the executives at Google, not only the HR people, realized how few people they have in the engineering space. And they actually prioritized that in figuring out how to recruit and how to do all of that back work. When they actually start seeing the numbers, and it was a good step, they published it, they were like, we know these numbers are really small, but we're going to fix it. And it's that recognition that you need to take the next step and getting it out of being an HR problem and into being an executive level problem, because it's making the product better if you have a more diverse workforce to pull from. And they'll recognize that once they see how bad it really is.
I've got research in my bag over there that I'm not gonna go pull out. But I work for Microsoft, so we also just got the Google thing, and Microsoft did it too, so we're putting together our new promotion materials for our school recruitment that's going to come up, and less than 25% of the employees at Google, Microsoft, Facebook, and one other that I can't think of off the top of my head, but those three big ones are female. And then when you further break it down into not just general employees, but the technical employees, the numbers get smaller because then they take out the HR people and the secretaries and the receptionists. But you break that down, we broke it down, or the study I have broke it down even further into the minority distribution, and it's really shocking that how many of the minority hires, especially in the female category, are non-existent. The vote majority of the females are white for the most part. It's a small number, but it's even smaller when you start looking at Asian, African American, Native American is almost non-existent.
Can I throw something in on that? And I know these ladies here, of course, so I definitely don't want to take too long. It's very important, and it's something that Mika brought up. Look, if people are going to think that you do what you do or got what you got because you look like what you look like, that's, you really can't do a whole lot about that. When I mention the places I've been to school, I know, and I mean, you know, be honest, there's people, oh, must have been one of those affirmative action things she got in there or whatever. Oh, maybe she's okay. Let me tell you something about the what has become almost the dirty word of affirmative action, right? You know, the big AA word. First of all, you got to understand not only the facts and the data, but the history. Affirmative action programs, as they were started, say, coming out of the 60s and 70s in the U.S., the greatest beneficiary of those programs, and I say beneficiary in quotes because it's still a small number, were actually white American females. Not folks that look like me. I mean, most people think, oh, it's black people. It's actually been white American females. Now, that being said, that still, as I've shown you a little bit, and you can so certainly talk to me later and go in, that's still a small number. But, excuse me, what happens then is, you know, don't buy into the hype, right? So first, the people say, well, now we're going to call it diversity. And as I said at the beginning, diversity is a whole lot more than just race and gender, right? But here's what you need to let people know when you have the facts. Diversity and excellence are not mutually exclusive.
Yeah, they
so for example, in 2015, LSU had its most diverse class, according to the higher ups that are the key people that know this, in terms of race, gender, socioeconomic, sexual orientation, religion, you name it, and also had the highest GPA, SATs. Now, what I'm saying is it's MIT, but it was the highest. So you have to let people know that people want to know what helps them, right? They don't want to know what helps you. So what helps them is, as some of the ladies mentioned here, when you have a more diverse group, how do you know that person sitting next to you that maybe isn't quite who you'd hang out with isn't the person that's going to be your partner in the Nobel Prize you're going to win? So you've got to open up that mindset. Last thing I'll say on that is, and we'll get back to recruiting, I've been on umpteen faculty search panels. And there was one that we had recently, and the bottom line of it was that I was not seeing any women being what we call shortlisted, invited to give interviews on campus. And not only women, but actually, say for example, in my department, there's maybe four people from the U.S., and everybody else is from everywhere else in the world. Now, if I lived in another country, I'd certainly want to see more Americans, right? But what happens is you get comfortable, so we see a whole lot of folks, excuse me, maybe not coming in the U.S. or coming from elsewhere, which is fine, except when it blocks people, anybody, right? It would be illegal if you say we're not going to hire black people, but what if you say, I'm not going to look at anybody from the U.S., I'm not going to look at anybody from China, I'm not going to look at anybody from Iran because I'm from X, okay? So when you have these search committees, as I pointed out to the group, I was on the committee, it was me, two guys from Korea, one guy from China, and one white American male, and I said to them, every single one of us has been somebody's diversity hire at some point in this university's history. LSU was thought, I'm just using LSU as an example, so that's where I am. LSU started in the 1850s. In 1882, the United States passed Chinese immigration laws to stop people from China from coming to the U.S. Those laws sit on the books for 60 years. So I turned to my colleague and I said, who's from China, I said, do you think you would have been able to get a job here? And I know you're not born in the 1800s, but just think of the history. Somewhere in the history of my university, somebody had to say, we're going to let Chinese people, you know, work here. Korean War, 1950s, I turned to my two colleagues from Korea, think you guys would have gotten a job at the time? No. And then I turned to my colleague who's a white American male and I said, hey, I'll call him Bob. Bob, are you from Houston? He said, no, I've worked there. I said, no, are you from Houston? He says, no. I said, well, then you would not have been able to go to my alma mater, Rice University, whose original charter was only for white males of Harris County. So a whole bunch of us in here couldn't have gone to Rice, right? And so every single one of us, and probably was on, not it wasn't called affirmative action, it wasn't called diversity, but someone in a position of power had to say, I'm going to open my mind to somebody like that, who maybe has the talent to come into my world. So diversity is not just what you see up here, it's you. As I told my colleagues, before you consider diversity as, oh, that's just Theda on the panel, she's on the committee, she's gonna talk about it, I said, you look in the mirror, because every single one in this room fell into somebody's diversity list at some point. And all of us in that room, I know I thought so, I said, I know you guys think you're eminently qualified to do what you do. So if you are eminently qualified to do what you do, but at some point somebody has to make the decision to let you do it, when you think about diversity, look in the mirror, don't just look at me.
Well, there's another thing about diversity. It's not just whether you're male or female or what ethnic diversity you are. For our projects to be successful at JPL, we also need diversity in age. Mm-hmm. Because if you're trying to solve a problem, you need people with different, you know, experiences to try and help us solve that problem, because I worked at JPL for 18 years, and so I have preconceptions about when I'm going into designing a rover, what I think will and won't work. But then if you take young person from college, mm-hmm. you know, they're more willing to think outside the box because they haven't suffered through what I've suffered and learned the hard way. And you need those people, so we call the older people, older than me, gray beards. And I'm mid-career, and then we have the fresh out. And for a project to succeed, you need a little of each. And the more diverse they can be, the better it is. And so I'm really lucky at JPL that, you know, years and years ago when there weren't actual plug-in and put your stuff in computers, they had these women that were called the computers, and that's what their job was, is that they did all the math. And so they worked in this one building at JPL, building 11, and when the real computers came in, the lady who was in charge of the computers, and she only hired women because she wanted her girls to get along, and when the real computers came in, she made sure that they were the first programmers at JPL, and so they all learned to program the computers, and so they became invaluable. Whereas some other organizations, when the real computers came along, the plug-in computers, they got rid of these women. JPL made them engineers. And so there's a nice, you know, flow into what I do now. In fact, one of the ladies that worked for one of the original computers is the one who hired me, because she was really interested in getting more women on lab. Where JPL comes up short is when you get into the higher management. That's where you see the old white boys.
So to wrap that up there, one of the other chunks of data is that when you have more diversity on projects, the projects are more successful, solve more problems, and make more money. So if you are in a position where you are trying to put together a group of people to do something cool, make sure that you're not filling it with just your friends who think like you do. Find people who think completely differently and have totally different backgrounds, and you're more likely to succeed and make more money.
Make more money. Make more money.
Hi, thank you. Something that I've struggled with that seems to be getting better over time, but I'm not sure it's ever going to go away. So I want to know if you feel this way, and if it does fade, is that I'm going to be outed as a fraud. I'm the only engineer that's a female at my company.
It has a name.
Speak more into the mic.
Okay. I'm the only female engineer at my company. I'm also the only chemical engineer, which means I have the expertise that they need, but I still carry this fear that at some point someone's going to come to me and say, no, you're wrong, your data's wrong, you're a fraud, why do you even work here?
It's called imposter syndrome, and it's incredibly common. Yeah. It doesn't go away, it just changes form.
I have a friend who's a member of the National Academy of Engineering, which is like the highest you can be. He's a white American male, and he felt exactly the same way earlier on in his career, and he said he always felt like somebody was going to pop up and go, you really don't know this. And he's at the highest end, so it's okay. Just keep going.
I kind of feel like that now because I think they're all much smarter than I am. and they do much cooler things than I do. I've spent most of my career in education, and they're rocket scientists.
But without you, we wouldn't be rocket scientists. Thank you. My parents are just... I have 42 years apiece in New Orleans public school system. My dad, high school math teacher and guidance counselor. My mom, elementary school. So thank you. Because to me, you're the real teachers.
Okay, we don't have to spend a lot of time on this because we talked about education already, but since I'm a student currently, that's what I've learned so far. I actually feel like a fish out of water here because I originally wanted to be a ballerina, but that didn't happen. So I went back to school, and my first semester I had a chemistry course and loved it, and that's what I'm studying to do now. I want to be a chemist, but it took such convincing for myself to do it because even like in high school and middle school, there's such a stigma that math is hard, physics is hard, so you'll never be able to do it, and only a select few. It took me from like buying a book at Barnes & Noble and just going through the problems and me realizing, oh, this isn't that bad, and I bought a physics book, and then I realized this is half chemistry anyway. And so then now I finally feel confident enough, but that's all I wanted to add to that. If we somehow could take the cultural aspect of math being difficult and change that. I mean, it's not so bad in college, but or sometimes high school, but that's one of the main concerns
so
that I have.
So you to help with that.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I do my best.
When Kim was talking about the computers of being women who do math, this is a huge cultural thing where for a big chunk of time, all the math tasks were given to women because men get bored too easily and can't do math. Like, that was the logic. It's the reason we have stellar classification systems is because of a group of women who went through looking at all the glass plates and realized the stars were different. That was my granny. So my heritage, I have escaped slaves who came from the Northern Railroad, the Underground Railroad to Canada. So a black woman in the like pre-war era, huge amounts of stigma against that. Her job was to go around doing math in public to get people to buy calculators. Like, that was her job, and the reason she did it is because it is basic, menial, mental math, and is so boring and dull, and it's the only thing that she would be capable of doing. So, and then, of course, you know, several decades later, now women can't do math, and they're not allowed because they're not clever enough. Like, it's clearly a cultural thing that is utterly messed up. Mm-hmm. Like, we just need to look at our own history to know how ridiculous it is.
Thank you.
Oh, I love you. What cosplay are you doing?
I'm just a hedgehog.
Oh. Hedgehogs are amazing. I have a pet hedgehog, so you and I are now besties.
I have turtles, though, not hedgehogs.
So. It's okay. It's all
close enough.
I love her.
But I guess going back to something that you said earlier, going back to something that you said earlier. So I'm an avionics engineer, and in my branch, there's about 300 people, and out of that, I am the only black person, and one of only two women. So I guess and also the youngest, because I think I'm 23, and like the next youngest person from that is about 31, I believe.
Early to make a career jump.
First, you're phenomenal.
But how do I change that, I guess? Where do I start with this?
So in some ways, I think one of the most amazing things right now is we have the internet and we can find communities elsewhere. So although you are the only one at your company, there are others elsewhere in the world and you can find them and cling to them and have a bit more. That I found my tribe of field working women. Because fieldwork is weird and bizarre in its own special magical way. And without finding them online and without finding that support group online, I don't know if I would have made it through my first year.
And talk to the people up here when this is over. You're right in the room. There we go.
Thank you. Also, I have
One thing we're trying to do with the group I'm working with is give positive role models. And I'm always looking for female volunteers in computer science to help me go into classrooms and show the girls that we can do it and we kick butt when we do it. And that helps build a population coming up behind you. If you want to help out with the younger generations, then get involved, volunteer, go to a classroom, show them that there are women in this field doing it and what they can do. Because I work in schools right now across the Southeast and across the country where they've never seen a female programmer, they've never seen a female computer scientist, they've never seen a female engineer, and they don't know anybody in their family that does it. And just being able to see it, we've had so many students go, oh, well, now I didn't know I could do this, now I'm going to go see about what it would take to go to Georgia Tech or to local university and look at computer science courses or look at physics courses, look at engineering, you know, and that's what's sad to me is how many students aren't exposed to the fact that that the possibility is out there. And a lot of it is not that their parents don't think they're smart enough, their parents don't know the opportunities are out there and what they can do with it.
I've got a great story there that ties into gaming. I go to a gaming group at a local store where there's several different tables and we're all playing Dungeons and Dragons. And there's some there's a bunch of guys there and there's some women that go as well. And some of the women, their moms, they're bringing their kids in. And at one of the tables, it just happened one day that there was a game where there was like four women there and one guy and the dungeon master. And the daughters were there. And I saw one of the daughters. She was probably about 8 or 9 years old. She was kind of looking around the table. And it was four women playing D&D, and I saw it was kind of in her mind like, okay, you grow up and you play D&D. That's what women do. And so, yeah, role models are so important.
So as a quick like pair of plugs here, Science Now is a nonprofit organization. It is currently doing, it's collecting photos of women in science to use to illustrate an upcoming story. Bethany Brookshire of Sci-Curious, who's talking other places on DragonCon, is the woman in charge of that. I'll tweet out a link to it afterwards. If you're a woman in science or engineering, they would love to use your photo for this piece. They've got every continent covered at this point. If they end up with too many photos, they will run it for the next month to use all the photos. So any woman in science and engineering, or specifically anyone who identifies as a non-man gender, so it's very fluid in this. I'm not quite sure how to do the vocabulary smoothly yet because I don't have much practice yet. Please, if you want to help expand the idea of what a scientist looks like, they're really looking right now to try and capture that. I know that we're very lightweight on the early career end of things as well, that we have more senior people and fewer early career scientists and engineers.
Just so you know, you got one, two, three, about four more questions, yeah. Just in terms of timing.
Yeah, I got 3 minutes.
Okay. Thank you. Right. I'll save my other question for after then.
Yeah, okay. August, a lot of this, we don't bite. Come on up.
No, I bite.
I only bite people who call me little lady, so it's okay.
If you can ask my 13-year-old, he's developed the term bite me, and I do bite him.
And I'm afraid this is going to be the last question.
Okay. Give him one more.
I'll try and make it quick.
She was waiting so long with me in the black. I know this.
Yeah, she's very enthusiastic.
We'll try.
I'm currently a student in electrical and computer engineering technology. So while going to school, I wanted to pursue like a job in like electronics. You know, I wanted something in the field. Applied for a bunch of jobs.
Talk to me after. I'll be glad to help you. Seriously, just come up. We'll talk.
I would love that. And I managed to get a job. Told them, oh, I'm a student in this field, I want to work with electronics, and they put me as a merchandiser. And while I was a merchandiser, my coworkers kept asking me, why are you not in sales? You know more about this than most of the sales guys. And I'm like, eh, I don't know, but I had this nagging feeling that it might have been because I'm female and didn't look like the typical computer.
But you still learn stuff. You learn
sales.
From every situation. If this one of these articles I gave you, one of the people that was studying this is an anthropologist. We get studied by anthropologists. Okay, so it's okay. But I'm glad to talk.
And I was just like wondering. Now I'm looking for a new job, and I'm like, what do I put on my resume and interview so people take me seriously in my field?
Apparently you're about to discover your new mentor.
If not, and so I want to hear, this lady has been sitting there staring at us, and I just want to hear what her question is.
Hi. In the resume, if you have like an engineering job and then you're stuck somewhere and you're worried about going forward, you can just leave it off. Or you can say you were consulting at a company. But human resources people, they know when they look at this stuff. And you do not have to put every single thing you've ever done on your resume.
You put the relevant things, not everything.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
It also helps to be named a man's name. I know it sounds awful.
You get named by
but
you.
I'm a,
that has to, that's true.
I'm a scientist. Well, it's true. I am a scientist. I have two daughters. And I understand what you're saying about being a woman, it is extremely important to be very strong and convicted on what you want. I mean, I just kind of happen to come from a family that's like that. No means nothing to me. So, and I have two daughters, and as an experiment, I actually named one of them Adrian, spelled like a man's name, because I wanted to know what kind of opportunities she was going to miss. And she actually has gotten so many more opportunities because people think she's a man. And when they get in her an interview, they are actually surprised that she is a female.
Yeah. I've had people who called me Mike for years and I just never correct them. So one way around this is you can always use your first initial.
That's exactly
right. Do first
right.
initial, last name,
JK.
And
unless your first initial is Y like mine, so it means nothing. So you just have to push your way in, and it's not hard. You know what you want. You mean nothing. No means nothing. What can it do? It doesn't kill you. You just go to the next person. and you go forward.
One thing we've got to do, I'll just say this for me as a quick one, is as much as this is in the panel on women in science and technology, I have two sons, right? One of the things that women don't do many times is we're not as big as self-promoters. So I've got to tell you this, but it's not just being a bragging mom. The point is as follows. I'm not even looking at him because he said, oh, mom, don't do this, but it's for other people, it's not for him. We got one kid who's now ranked first in the state of Louisiana. I know it ain't New York, but Louisiana in physics. No, I did not do a science project. I did not help him because I don't do optics at all. But he won first place in the state science fair in physics in the junior division, 6th through 8th grade. Likewise, we got another son who just finished college, got his bachelor's in computer science, got out of LSU, good old LSU, had a couple of years before that at Howard University, more liberal arts university. He got 10 job offers like Intel, Dell, Microsoft, Google. He got 10 grad schools acceptances, Stanford, Carnegie Mellon, Northwestern, etc. Now, are they, I'm their mom, are they whiz kids? No, these are, as she said, they're persistent. But the reason I said that, and even though they're two little boys, is to point out all the, moms, dads, and you have little girls, let people know. It's not about you just being a bragging parent. Like I said a minute ago, you don't know who's in this room that might be the next step for your child or yourself. So let them know.
Yeah, it's related to that is you can pitch yourself. Pitch yourself to the places you're an alumna from saying, hey, I want to come back and give presentations. Pitch yourself to your PR department saying, I'm willing to be an interview source. Pitch yourself to journalists if you have a cool story. I can tell you, we're always looking. This goes for men and for women, because guess what? We can't change culture alone. We can't only use half the population to change culture. We all gotta pitch in and try and make things a little bit more human and kind to each other. So we can change how we're seeing things, but it takes going out there and trying to make those changes happen.
And no matter how shy you are, there's a contribution you can make. Just ask.
So we're out of time, but this has been an amazing conversation. This topic will continue at 2:30, so that's about a half an hour from now, upstairs in Hilton 208, 209. We'll be showing a documentary called Decode, debugging the what?
Code.
Debugging the gender gap. So we can definitely continue there. Thank you so much to everyone that's been on the panel.